welcome to this second session of this series on the signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in history, nature, and the soul. What distinguishes our approach from other approaches is that we approach history as a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our approach is based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before I get started, I'll answer two questions that were raised at the end of the last session. One question was, please tell us again how history, science, and the soul are interrelated. It is very simple. Please do not think history. Think signs from Allah. Please do not think science. Think signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please do not think the soul or the nafs, but look at the signs within the nafs, the signs within our soul. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us and gave us the capability to read the signs that He shows us on the horizon, which is nature and history, and also the signs that are within each of us. Every lady, every man has the capability, and every lady and every man has the sign within her or within him. That is the relationship between history, science, and the soul. It is an integrated approach based upon Tawheed. Knowledge is one, because truth is one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. And everything derives from Tawheed. There's only one hope. That was one question. And there are some other questions too that were asked. Inshallah, I'll take them at the end. Today, inshallah, our focus is on the Khilafat of Abu Bakr Siddique radiallahu anhu. Once again, as we go into these historical events, please do not look upon them as something happened on such and such a date, or there was a conflict or a war. There are too many narrations based upon conflicts and wars. But please always ask yourself, what is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaching us through these events? And ultimately, we have to learn to apply them to our own lives here in America. What is happening and what will happen, what may happen, Allah knows the future, will be a challenge. So we should look at the signs that Allah has given us through revelation and read them, learn from them, and apply them to our own situation. Summary. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq provided the bridge between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and historical Islam. Please always be aware of what is in the Quran. I have said in my khutbas as well as my lectures and my interactions and my private discourses that if there is one thing that we need to do, that is to study the Quran. Study the Quran. The answers are all there. So be aware of what is in the Quran as exposed by the Sunnah of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The seerah, that is the path, the process, the approach that he took to solve the problems that he encountered in his life, and historical Islam. Last week, we covered the Shia Sunni split. A historical split, not based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet. Please always make the distinction. Be aware. Ask yourselves, what is history? What is revelation? It is very important. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq waged an unceasing struggle to preserve the institution of zakat and to silence the false prophets who sprang up all over Arabia. He continued the defensive measures taken by the Prophet ﷺ to guard the Muslim homeland against external threats from the Persian and the Eastern Roman Empire. The Eastern Roman Empire is also sometimes called as the Byzantine Empire. The Quran, as it was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, had been committed to the memory of the Huffaz. After the Battle of Yamama, which we'll go into in some detail later, when a large number of Huffaz perished, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu ordered the Quran to be committed to paper. This first writing is known as Mashab al-Siddiq. We must emphasize here, that Mashab al-Siddiq was a documentation, not a compilation. It was a documentation, not a compilation. The compilation and arrangement of the Quran was done by the Prophet ﷺ himself, as it was revealed to him in Makkah and Medina. It's a very important distinction because the question comes up very often. Every word in the Quran is as it was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ. Every word. Mashaf al-Siddiqi had no vowels. When Arabic speaking people write their letters, you can read them, seldom do they add the vowels and the kasra and the shidda. Those who speak Arabic know how to read it. However, it presented a challenge, as we'll see later, as the Islamic domains expanded to the faraway corners of the earth. Among the spiritual circles, that is the Sufis, which is the spiritual dimension of Islam, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq is known for ma'rifah. It's a big word. Or the inner knowledge which he received from the Prophet ﷺ during the Hijrah, when they sought refuge together in Ghar al-Tawr, the cave at Tawr, which is a cave in Mount Tawr near Makkah. An event that is celebrated in the Quran, in the ayah, La tahzan, inna Allah ma'ana. Do not grieve. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. The Prophet said, and these are recorded in the ahadith, what I received, I poured into the heart of Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr Siddiq is a towering personality in Islamic history. While Khadija al-Kubra radiallahu anha was the first lady to accept Islam, and Ali radiallahu anhu was the first youth to accept Islam, Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu was the first free adult to accept Islam. His trust in the Prophet was unflinching, unqualified, unflinching. When the Prophet called him to Islam, Abu Bakr Siddiq accepted immediately and unhesitatingly. When the Prophet revealed his ascension during Miraj, and so many people doubted the narration, Abu Bakr Siddiq did not flinch. His dedication to the master was total, complete. These are signs. This is what we have to learn. When we ask ourselves, our children, what can they learn from Abu Bakr Siddiq? Learn his unflinching obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Unqualified, total. Total surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first, and then to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the Prophet called for donations for a campaign, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu gave all he had, everything. When he was asked, "Oh Abu Bakr, what have you left for your family?" He replied, "Allah and His Messenger. That's enough." When he felt terminally ill, Prophet honored Abu Bakr by appointing him to lead the prayers. The highest honor in an Islamic community is to ask someone to lead the prayers. That's the reason we say when we visit somebody's house, that person is the imam in his house, no matter who he is. And it is his privilege to lead the prayer. Unless he insists that somebody else lead the prayer, he is the imam. In his house, he is the imam. And there are agreed upon rules as to who is qualified to be the imam. Not everybody is an imam. After he became the Khalifa, Abu Bakr Siddiq said to the believers, "I have been given authority over you, and I'm not the best amongst you. If I do well, then help me. If I do wrong, set me right. Obey me only so long as I obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only so long as I obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. But if I disobey God and His Messenger, you owe me no obedience." Abu Bakr understood that leadership was a trust from Allah. Look at our leaders today. Ask yourselves, are they learning? Are they following the Quran? We talked about the seerah of the Prophet, the ijma of the Sahaba, the Sufis and the Salafis, modernists and the traditionalists. Are the leaders following the commandment of Allah? Are they looking upon what they have as a trust from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be discharged with justice and responsibility? A question to ask ourselves. Upon accession to the Khilafat, Abu Bakr Siddiq was faced with several crises. The immediate issue, and these are some details, I will go into it, rapidly read them, was the dispatch of defensive forces to the north to contain the Roman armies. See, in our history we call them Romans. In the Western histories they call them Byzantines. It's just a designation that they came up with. The Muslims had faced a stalemate with the Byzantines at the Battle of Tabuk and had lost the leader Zayd bin Haris. A follow-up defensive expedition had been initiated by the Prophet to safeguard the northern approaches to Medina. Abu Bakr Siddiq reaffirmed the decision of the Prophet and dispatched an expedition under Usama bin Zayd. The expedition was successful. The second challenge was the refusal of certain Arab tribes to pay the zakat. This is an important point. Zakat. How many of us pay the zakat? If all the Muslims of the world paid the zakat as per the injunction of the Quran, there would be no poverty in the Muslim community. People don't pay the zakat. See what happened here. Pre-Islamic Arabia was tribal. Many of these tribes had reluctantly accepted Islam towards the last days of the Prophet ﷺ. When he passed away, these tribes saw an opportunity to stop paying the mandatory zakat because they thought it was another tax. Zakat is not only a moral obligation in Islam, it's also a legal obligation. In America, it's not a legal obligation because we follow the American law. But it is a moral obligation because it's a commandment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pay your zakat. There's goodness in it. There's falah for the individual and the community. It is an act of purity. It is regarded as one of the five pillars of Islam. In Islam, the economic well-being of humankind is as important as that of the individual. Your brother's well-being is as important as your own well-being. Please remember that what you earn, what you have on your table, is not because you earned it. It is there because Allah gave it to you. I have known so many PhDs in my life, last 50 years in America, who cannot find a job. And I have known people who cannot write their name, signature. They're loaded with bundles of money. Comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Please remember that. The Quran discourages hoarding, forbids riba, and encourages sharing, investment, and trade. Zakat works to circulate money and operates against hoarding. Do not hoard wealth. Invest wisely. Wisely, that's important. Wisely, not randomly. Whenever the Quran emphasizes the establishment of prayer, it also emphasizes charity and zakat. Foregoing zakat would have destroyed the moral foundation of the nascent Islamic State and would have reduced Islam to a litany of personal beliefs and observances. Abu Bakr Siddique conducted a vigorous police action against the non-payers of zakat. It was a legal obligation on his part. He was the head of state. Some people ask me, was it appropriate, proper to force people to pay zakat? It is like the President of the United States. He is obligated to protect the law. If somebody doesn't follow the law will ask that individual to comply. It is that application in here. The third crisis faced by Abu Bakr Siddiq was that of false prophets. And this is also a very important issue. Seeing the success and the prosperity of the Muslims, many false prophets and prophetesses sprang up all over Arabia. Religion was, and remains to this day, good business. I repeat, religion was and remains to this day good business. Read the writings of Ali Shariati. You'll understand them. Many a pretender those days saw in the success of Islam an opportunity to establish his own religion and get rich in the process. Abu Bakr declared war on the false prophets. He sent 11 expeditions against as many pretenders. Of these, the best known was the expedition of Khalid bin Walid against Musaylimah al-Kazzab. You hear the name again, al-Kazzab, the false one, the liar, which culminated in the Battle of Yamama, a very important battle. Similar expeditions were sent towards Yemen, Oman, and Hadifa. All of these expeditions were successful. It was in the campaign against Musaylimah al-Kazzab that a large number of companions of the Prophet ﷺ perished. Many of them were Hufaz, those who had memorized the Quran in their heart. The Quran was revealed to the Prophet ﷺ as the spoken word. It came into existence as the spoken word. There are multiple meanings in there. It's a very powerful statement. Word, as opposed to written material, which was then memorized by hundreds of his companions. It was the age of the spoken word. And the Arabs were very proud of their language and their eloquence. They were very good in the language, and rightfully so. The martyrdom of so many Hufaz in the Battle of Yamamah was a matter of great concern to the companions. Upon the advice of Umar ibn al-Khattab, Abu Bakr Siddiq ordered the writing down of the Quran to preserve it as it was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As it was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for all generations to come. And ours is the 40th generation after the Prophet. The first written copy of the Quran is known as Mashhab-e Siddiq. In the geopolitics of West Asia, neither the Byzantines nor the Persians could tolerate an independent, united, and strong Arabia. Both powers coveted the Arabian Peninsula for centuries. The Romans had occupied Syria and Jordan, while the Persians had subjugated Iraq, Yemen, and Hejaz. To the geopolitical element was now added the religious element. Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, in the fulfillment of his mission as the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, had sent greetings to the rulers of these two powers, inviting them to accept Islam. Heraclius, the Byzantine emperor, had sent a polite reply, but had ordered his troops into action on the northern borders of Arabia, into Syria. Remember, when we say Syria, historical Syria includes what is today Syria, Jordan, territories that people call Israel, Palestine, and a great portion of even western Iraq and eastern Turkey. That's the term, when we use the term Syria, please remember that. Khosrow, the Persian emperor, had torn up the Prophet's letter and had ordered his forces in Yemen to march on Medina and arrest the Prophet. This is not known. People say, why they wage war on the Persians? They wage war on the Romans? No. They were defending themselves. The Romans wanted to move in from the north. The Persians were even worse. Khosrow had ordered his forces in Yemen to go north along the Red Sea, Mecca and Medina, and arrest the Prophet ﷺ. It's not known. But soon, political developments in West Asia worked in favor of the emerging Islamic State. There was murder and mayhem in the Persian court. The weakness of the Persian Empire invited retribution from the Romans, and is celebrated in the Quran, Surah Rum, where the Romans recaptured a large number of territories that had been captured by the Persians. For a long period, the tribes in Eastern Arabia had enjoyed the protection of the Persian court, but Khosrow unwisely had alienated them. All these events were in favor of the Muslims, who waged a series of campaigns, not only to recover the territories in what is modern Iraq, what they call the Lesser Arabia, but also east of the Euphrates and ultimately the Tigris River. Abu Bakr Siddiq turned his attention to the north, towards Syria. When he sent an expedition, he gave instructions to the army. And I want to read those instructions to you. Very important. Very important. He said, do not harm children, women, and old men. Put them, juxtapose them if you will, against what happens these days. These were the ethical standards dictated to by Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Do not harm children, women, and old men Apply them to some of the things that are going on these days. Do not harm the disabled. Do not disfigure the bodies of those killed in battle. Do not destroy standing crops. Do not cut down trees. Do not be dishonest. Do not misappropriate war booty. Do not kill animals, except as is necessary for food. Those were the ethical standards. High standards that they have. What kind of standards do we have these days? These injunctions have served for kings and soldiers alike as a canonical basis for a Muslim code of ethics for the last 1400 years. The code is there. Do people follow it? I leave it to you to decide. All these campaigns, both in the East and in the North, were successful. And we can read about them in the history books. That is not important. What is important is the ethical basis of the campaigns that this great man waged. The ethics, the raison d'etre. Why did he first of all initiate the actions that he did? What were the ethical paradigms, frameworks, governing his actions, the constraints? Of course, he was successful. But how did he treat those who he vanquished? Abu Bakr Siddiq accomplished so much in such a small time. He provided the bridge between the prophetic period and historical Islam. The prophet, we can study the prophet as the prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a special study. So often people say, the prophet did it, so I will do it. Come on. Be careful when you say that. The prophet was the prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was a bashar, a man, but not like any other bashar. He was the prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's like saying, Jesus did this and therefore I'm going to do. I was in Galilee at one time. I saw the place where Jesus said to have walked on water. We believe that. So Jesus walked on water, so I'm going to also say, I'm going to walk on water. Somebody will have to pull out my body. So, no, please be conscious of what is history. And what is the context of history? And who is doing it? And what are the ethical principles and the constraints? Without the leadership of Abu Bakr Siddiq, Zakat would have disappeared as an institution, and the nature of religion itself would have been altered. The legal basis of the state would have been seriously undermined, and the community would have fallen apart. Abu Bakr Siddiq continued the traditions of the Prophet, continuity. There is change and there is continuity. In America, when we migrated to America, we brought in a certain continuity. But there also has to be change, a different paradigm. There is the Constitution of the United States, the laws and rules and regulations, the opportunities and the challenges that we face. It's a different paradigm. Continuity and change, both take place at the same time. Abu Bakr, having continued the traditions of the Prophet ﷺ, overcame internal dissensions, established the rule of law. He suppressed false prophets and successfully defended the nascent Islamic State against the predatory reach of both the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire. He demonstrated that the Muslims were a living, dynamic community. Under his leadership, Islam embarked on the process of history, bereft of his prophet. The prophet was gone, but animated by the message of the Quran and his Sunnah. The Quran and the Sunnah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Astaghfirullah rabbi. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now, having heard a brief discourse on the period of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, let's now learn from each other. Any questions, comments, discourse? First from the ladies, and then from the men, and inshallah we'll continue. As long as you're thinking, I'll read from you one other question that was asked of me towards the end of the last session. Someone asked me, can you give an example from the life of the Prophet ﷺ about your observation that science is a study of the signs from Allah? They asked me for an example from the life of the Prophet ﷺ. Here is an example. The ahadith confirm that during the life of the time of the Prophet ﷺ, there was a solar eclipse. And the Prophet ﷺ told the Sahaba, in this there are signs from Allah. If our scientists, as they did for 500 years, had continued the search looking at nature for the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would not have fallen behind in science. They stopped doing it. They said to themselves, it's the will of Allah. And then they stopped there. See, an explanation would be something along the following lines. The soul is like a mirror. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the universe. And His hand is there in the history of human beings. Nature is reflected in that mirror. But then, the signs that we read, for instance, look at the moon, or the star, or a tree, a leaf, an atom, a proton, a string. Within that atom, there are other signs. So that atom itself becomes another mirror. So you have a mirror of the soul, and you have the atom, that's another mirror, and within that mirror, there are more signs, and then you go higher yet, there are yet more signs. So each station becomes a mirror. So you can imagine an infinite series of mirrors. That is a hint to the meaning of Nurun ala Nur. Nurun ala Nur in Surah An-Nur. Light upon light. How can you have multiple lights all at the same time? There is one sun. Let's say we have 10 receptacles, receivers, and convex lenses. And these 10 receivers focus the light onto a single pole, for instance, or a pot containing water. Within no time, that pot of water will boil. Same thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us multiple different reflectors. Everything that He has created is a reflector. It is giving us that light for the intellect that He has bestowed upon us. So that through them, we say, Subhanallah, how beautiful is my Creator. How great is my Creator. How noble is my Creator. How giving is my Creator. And then we bow down and worship Him and serve Him. See, the example from the life of the Prophet, so those who don't know, they say, what he said, the solar eclipse was a sign? People don't know. People don't know, and they don't think about the prophetic language. Everything the Prophet said, as is the Quran, has multiple meanings. Question? Yes, sir.
So, one question and one quick comment.
Please.
Was there any false prophet during prophet time?
Prophet time? Not that I know of. There probably were, but I'm not. That does not mean there aren't, but I'm not aware of.
Just Arabian Peninsula.
Does anyone else know? The question is, were there any false prophets during the time of the Prophet ﷺ? Does anyone know if there was one? I do not. That does not mean the answer is no, but to my knowledge, no.
The second part is, if you read about Jang Yaman, it was so bloody, and the dedication to Musalama of his people, that really confuses me. He was a false prophet, and they gave life for him until the end. They fought really bravely, actually. So how would you explain that?
Well, you know, look at modern warfare. Why do nations go to war? These for what purpose? Ali Sharifi, one of the most incisive thinkers of the 20th century, he pointed out that when you have the coalescence combination of three items, that spells danger. One is money, wealth. Two is politics, and three is religion. You put them all together, you have an explosive mixture. So why do modern armies fight so hard, if not for wealth and money? How can we explain the warfares that have gone on in the last, whatever, umpteen number of years? So people fight for all kinds of reasons, but those who are defending themselves because of the faith, that is legitimate. But that's the explanation that I can think of. Can anyone else think of another reason? Yes.
He was also loving obeying. He was also thinking that he is going to be the leader, and he gave him a hard time to the Prophet. And he might be the
Doctor?
Yes.
In your lecture, you said that the institution of zakat would have vanished or damaged, compromised,
yes,
had Hazrat Abu Bakr not taken that stand. That's true, and that's what most historians say. But let's have a look at the same thing from a different angle. The Muslim Ummah was not just new. It was in the process of getting a shape. It was not a simple question of deviating from one of the five pillars of Islam. But it was a direct challenge to the establishment of the Ummah, in the making of which our noble Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had tired himself. So there is much more in that, because if that were the case, like you mentioned, there are so many people here among us who don't pay the zakat. And another thing, look at, Hazrat Umar was known as a person with strong ideas. But here we have a clear reversal of roles, that Hazrat Umar was in a way willing to compromise on this issue, because most of the people who refused to pay the zakat, they used to pray five times. But Hazrat Abu Bakr, who was very very kind-hearted person, a different kind of person. But he took a very strong stand here. So don't you think that it was not a question of simply not paying the zakat? It was a question of revolt.
Good observations. The ijtihad of the Sahaba is something that is hard to decipher. Later, for instance, we'll cover the civil wars. In other words, how did they read, look upon, and understand the injunctions of the Quran and the guidance of the Prophet so that they came up with whatever conclusions and decisions they did? the ijtihad of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq in consultation with the Sahaba at the time was to wage war against those who were not paying the zakat. Now, can we ask ourselves whether it was the correct ijtihad or not? Could things have been different? All we can do is to look at how they approached it, what the decision was, and what consequences emerged from it. To ask ourselves what type of a scenario is a good exercise, and you're right in pointing out there have been occasions when other rulers, including Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, he turned the other way when some people did not pay. But my submission would be that we ought to honor the ijtihad that was there, that is there, and ask ourselves what can we learn from it. Could it have been different? Could have been different. But that's the big pass.
During the time of Hazrat Abu Bakr, what was the role of Hazrat Umar, Hazrat Usman, Hazrat Ali? Did they have any certain, were they posted to certain things? Were they responsible for certain things?
They were the companions, the ijtihad of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu formed the basis of the Maliki fiqh in later years. The decisions that were taken in the 2 years and 3 months of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq's Khilafat and the 10 years or so of Hazrat Umar's Khilafat formed the basis of the Maliki Fiqh. So what was their role? They were consultants. They used to have Shura, the Ijma. Sometimes they all agreed, sometimes they did not agree. And that's, again, when we go into the various different schools of fiqh, we'll see that some schools insist on the collective ijma of all the sahaba, whereas some schools of fiqh accept the ijma of only some of the sahaba. So the answer to your question is, they were there as advisors, as people with whom the Khalifa consulted before he embarked on a campaign or undertook a certain decision. Ladies, if any comment from the ladies?
Now, just one regarding the question about false prophets. In Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ said that before Yawm al-Qiyamah there will be about 15 false prophets. My reading of that, I could be wrong, would be they would have to be it would have to be outside of like a small group to be one of those 15. In other words, if it was someone claiming to be a prophet who only had 30 followers with the millions of people in the world, that wouldn't seem to be one of those. But I would think it would mean a sizable number of people in the world would be following a false prophet to be able for that one to be included.
We should be cognizant of that.
Mm-hmm. Just one comment about the false prophet. Oh, sorry.
Yes. You're waiting for a long time. Please go ahead.
It's slightly off topic, but I was wondering around towards the end of the Battle of Tabuk, the expedition to Tabuk, the Prophet, peace be upon him, had an incident with Bukhader Malik. He was a king around the northern Syria area, and I think that was one of the earliest agreements of jizya with the Ummah and the non-Muslim tribes. I was wondering if you could give...
It happened later, during the time of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, and inshallah we'll cover it next week. Sir.
Yeah, just a comment about the question that said, was there a false prophet at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself? So Musaylimah al-Kadhdhab was there. In fact, it was the Prophet who called him Al-Kadhdhab. So he wrote a letter to the Prophet asking him to share the kingdom among us. And said, no, you are alive. So he was there at that time. Yes.
Thank you for the clarification.
Just a question in regards to the whole Khilafah. What were the key accomplishments that you would say were accomplished by Abu Bakr Siddiq during his time of 2.5 years of Khilafah?
That's what I read. Very briefly, I count four of them.
Okay, I thought there were the challenges. But
well, number one, preserve the zakat. Second one, he defended the community against the predatory reach of the two empires, the Roman Empire and the Persian Empire. The documentation of the Quran was done under his leadership. And lastly, upholding the law, the establishment of the ethical basis of law, and upholding the law while providing the continuity. It was only 2 years that he was the Khalifa. Those, in my opinion, those four are his achievements. Can anyone else think of some other major achievement? The time of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. The biggest one was the documentation of the Quran. That was not an easy decision.
This is just a comment on that. The question was asked by Yasin, you know, the different roles assigned to the Sahaba. So clear four ministries were created by Hazrat Abu Bakr. Like the secretariat, looking after the caliphate's circle, it was assigned to Hazrat Ali. And communication was assigned to Hazrat Usman. Finance was assigned to Hazrat Ubayd Ansar. So clearly four ministries were almost created. So the shape of Ummah almost, after having gone through that turmoil, was given a proper shape. That's what I think.
I will cover that next week. My readings suggest that this was accomplished during the period of Umar radiallahu anhu. However, I stand to be corrected if indeed the initiative was taken at the time of Hazrat Abu Bakr. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq was so involved with these major activities, the conflicts that had to be taken care of, the warfare with the Persian Empire, the warfare with the Byzantine Empire, the false prophets, the writing down the Quran, etc. That I wonder if he did it. If you have references to it?
Yeah, I have.
Inshallah, what I will do is to include that in the encyclopedia. Appreciate the comment. One last question, hopefully from the ladies. One of the young ladies, they must have some questions or comments. Otherwise, we'll ask one of the young men. Must be a question. It is for you. Nothing.
I just had a quick question on zakat. What was the process of distribution for zakat?
They had a Baitul Mal. The Baitul Mal was under the jurisdiction of the Khalifa. And the Khalifa made the decisions as to how the amounts and whatever came into the Baitul Mal was to be distributed amongst the needy. That was the process.
Was it, when you think of zakat, I think kind of like the welfare system, was it encouraged for people to find means, you know, because now you're living off the state, to now help them find, whether it's educating them or finding them, you know, teaching them the skills to get out of this poverty and into something other than living off the state?
Good question. I do not know if that was in place. Good question. Does anyone know the answer to that? We accept the fact that it was distributed, but you're asking a very question. Did they teach them skills? I do not know the answer to that. Very last one. Yes.
Thank you. Okay, I'll ask this one. So when the Romans are visiting
say, is I believe there are two opinions on this. Some historians say that this was just to reaffirm their political strength after their defeat of the Persians. And some say it was to prepare for war on Medina. Do you have any historical evidences where you can be fooled about it?
Yes. The historical evidence was that even during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, there was an incursion from the Byzantine army, the Eastern Roman army, into what is today Jordan and northern Saudi Arabia. And that's the reason the Battle of Tabuk took place. And the Prophet ﷺ sent an expedition. And, you know, it was a stalemate. Yes, there is historical evidence. It's well documented. Thank you so much. That was fine. God bless you. Next week, inshallah, we'll cover the period of Hazrat Umar Farooq. And it's going to be